This episode of New Politics was released on the 15th of July, 2023, and produced on the land of the Wangal and Wajuk people.
Welcome to New Politics. In this episode, we look at the continuing fallout from the Robodebt disaster and the calls for Scott Morrison to resign from Parliament. The Prime Minister goes to Lithuania to discuss the future of NATO. The misinformation campaign against the government's proposed misinformation legislation. Some final observations on the Fadden by-election. And we have a new Reserve Bank governor. I'm Eddie Djokovic, editor of New Politics.
I'm David Lewis, still waiting to hear if I'm the new Reserve Bank governor.
And if you'd like to support New Politics, you can support us through a Patreon subscription, but whether it's a subscription or whether you just want to listen in, read our material online or buy a t-shirt or buy a book, it's all available at newpolitics.com.au, and all of this is a good way to support independent journalism. The fallout from the Robodebt Royal Commission report continues, and even though the media interest in this issue has dropped off and suggesting that this rules a line through the Robodebt problem, well, this really is just the beginning. There's so many more steps that need to continue with Robodebt, and probably the biggest noise so far this week has been the calls for former Prime Minister Scott Morrison to resign from Parliament. But even still, if Morrison does resign from politics, that's not the end of it for him. It's not the end of it for all of the other ministers that were involved, and that's Stuart Robert, Alan Tudge, Christian Porter, and there's probably other coalition cabinet ministers that might be implicated in this as well. And then there's certain members of the public service as well. And Catherine Campbell is the most public face of Robodebt within the public service. But there's others in there as well who will have to face the music. And there is a push from within the Liberal Party for Scott Morrison to resign. But if they think that it's just a case of removing Morrison from Parliament and then that will be the end of the Robodebt scandal, I think they're quite mistaken there.
It's gone much farther and much deeper than they think. I note that they've allowed Morrison to get all the blame. Now, he certainly deserves most of the blame, but not all of it. And of course, they're now using him as a scapegoat or a Trojan horse even to get all the opprobrium onto him. If they are able to force him out of his seat, that's one less problem for them next election, potentially. Certainly one less problem for them in Parliament, because while he's there, people are reminded of just how unpopular he was as Prime Minister. It's difficult because the only thing that can get him out of his seat is him retiring or resigning, or if he gets charged with Robodebt and he goes to jail for more than 12 months. Otherwise, he's in the seat till the next... Oh, the other thing, of course, that can get him out of the seat is losing the election. But before an election that he loses, the only two ways is that if he voluntarily, with all the implications that might hold, steps down, or if he is charged with appropriate crimes, and by appropriate, I mean we don't know, one, really if he's been charged or if he's been referred to charges, and two, what he's been charged with. But if he has been charged with crimes that warrant more than 12 months in jail, he will have to leave his seat then. He's a problem for the Liberal Party in all kinds of ways, but particularly in this way. Well, the longer he stays, the more damage he does, but there's not much they can really do to get him to leave. They could disendorse him from the party, but he's still in the seat for 2 years till the next election. So I don't know what they do.
I think there's no question that Scott Morrison should resign from Parliament, and we were actually calling for his resignation even before he entered Parliament, but he's the first Prime Minister to have entered Parliament after 2004, and that was when the superannuation changes were made so that MPs didn't receive a lifelong pension after just 8 years in office. So he'll end up with just the standard superannuation that everyone else gets, and office, desk, and free air travel. And I just don't think that there'd be that many people who'd buy his memoirs or go to listen to his public lectures. And of course, there will be people that would be interested, but it's just that he's not much of a draw card at the moment. And it's obvious that he's been looking around, but it's just that there doesn't seem to be very many people in the corporate world that are interested. He might be able to work at Optus with Gladys Berejiklian, but that's about it. And after the revelations from the Robodebt Royal Commission last week, and the strong possibility that Scott Morrison is one of those people from the sealed section of the report earmarked for possible corruption charges, and there's little likelihood of someone like him getting a prominent and well-paid post-political job. So I think when you take all of these issues into account, a $230,000 salary for being a backbencher, where he doesn't have to do any work at all in the safe seat of a cook for at least the next 2 years, I think that looks like a very promising position. And Morrison still does control the branches in the division of cook, and his grip has slipped a little bit since the last federal election, but he still controls the pre-selection in that seat. So that's the choice. Stay in Parliament for as long as you want, where you don't have to do very much, and you can go on family holidays to Italy, which is where he's just been, or go and get a job in the real world, where your job prospects, I think, are close to zero.
It's got to be understood, yes, that he doesn't have the pension. He gets his standard superannuation payout. I think he can take it at 60 at a lower rate and free tax before 60, but taxed, and then after 65 at the highest rate. He's, what, mid-50s now? So that's a long time to hold on to a seat. And you're right, nobody else wants him. If he was wanted in the job community, they'd have snapped him up by now. Even Josh Frydenberg, one of the worst and ineffective treasurers we ever had, got employed, Goldman Sachs. So even Josh Frydenberg was able to muster what political reputation he had into a high-paying job at Goldman Sachs. No company, I was going to say no reputable company, but I think even some of the non-reputable companies want a bar of Scott Morrison. This is obvious. He'd have gone by now. As an ex-prime minister, and for Morrison, it's not so much the decision-making and the work. It's the meals, it's the invitations, it's the glamour of the job, it's the doing nothing. It was the sitting on the porch at Kirribilli House looking out over the harbour, knocking off at 3 o'clock, and the big salary that attracted it to him. So it must be fairly miserable for him as a backbencher, fairly friendless on the backbench. Not completely, but fairly friendless, watching the party move on without you.
I'm pretty sure that he's still got all of his supporters within the Liberal Party as well, and also within the electorate, and within not just the electorate of Cook, but also the electorate across Australia. Like, there's 27 million people in Australia, so there'd be a level of support that he'd still have.
Yeah, but it's not the level of support that, say, Julia Gillard has, or that Paul Keating has, for example, or that Kevin Rudd has. Within the Pentecostal movement, he's still an important figure. But it's interesting that, so far as we can tell, he hasn't received a job offer at a pay rate that is commensurate to what he believes he can do.
And Scott Morrison has also rejected the adverse findings against him in the Robodebt Royal Commission report, saying that the commission didn't understand how government operates. And in some sense, that's true. No one could really understand how the Morrison government operated with all of those breaches of protocols, secret ministries, corruption and incompetence. And more of that information was contained in the Robodebt Royal Commission report. And no one can really understand how a scheme that was determined to be illegal and unconstitutional, but yet we had a government that still proceeded with it. And Morrison is also a pathological liar, and we discovered that over the 3.5 years of his prime ministership. He'll tell absolute lies even when he doesn't need to. So Morrison not accepting the findings of the report, that means absolutely nothing. So he just can't be trusted on anything at all. So there's no trust. There was never any value in having him in Parliament before, so there's no real value in having him in Parliament now. But as we've explained before, he's likely to stay in Parliament, and all the former prime ministers have had something to offer to the Australian community after they leave politics. And all of these prime ministers, Paul Keating, Malcolm Turnbull, Julia Gillard, Kevin Rudd, Bob Hawke and John Howard stayed out of the limelight after they left politics, but most of these people had something to offer, either in domestic politics or international politics. But with Morrison, there's just nothing. It's like a vacuum. And there's also talk about the Cronulla Sharks rugby league team removing Morrison as their number one ticket holder. And For a populist type of leader and for someone who is so deluded, this is probably the biggest blow. Rejected by the Cronulla Sharks after all the misbehaviours that were going on with bad player behaviour, salary cap rorting, drug cheating, and for them to turn around and say, oh, sorry, Scott, we can't have you as a member anymore, I think that would be the biggest blow to his ego.
Till he moved to the Cedar Cook, he was never the most avid rugby league fan. And there's been some suggestion that it was purely transactional. It was good for votes, so he became a rugby league fan. I think you're right, though. It would be the biggest blow of all. To lose that number one ticket means no more free games, for example. It means no more corporate box. He'd have to find someone else who'd let him sit in the corporate box. And there's been no more talk of that. Maybe they've decided to keep it on because the club doesn't want to get into the controversy with the club's own struggles with behaviour. They don't want to be seen called out for hypocrisy. Again, I don't know. I'm just going through options. But losing it would probably be a bigger blow than being told to not stand at the next seat by the Liberal Party. It might be an indication that he's not quite as popular as he thinks he is.
So enough about Scott Morrison for the time being and onto the mainstream media. But the mainstream media has been quick to drop Robodebt as a news item. And yes, it was reported, but it's almost like it's disappeared from the scene. And some of this is part of the modern 24-hour media cycle where they're just always on the lookout for new news. But I just can't help thinking that if this was a Labor government that had been caught up in an illegal scheme, we just never hear the end of it. Remembering that the Royal Commissions into Trade Unions and the Insulation Scheme had daily media coverage and reports for weeks after those Royal Commissions ended, but Robodebt, not so much, and the media never really had a strong interest in the Robodebt system anyway, and that was something that was kickstarted by independent media and social media, and primarily through Asher Wolf, through a range of Twitter campaigns over 5 years ago. And David, we're just a small independent media outfit, low budget, but we've managed to report on Robodebt quite prominently over the past few years. And if you want to find all the information, it's all out there. But if you don't want to look, you'll never find anything. And it was quite amusing seeing all of these mainstream journalists say how astonishing Robodebt was and they couldn't believe how terrible it all was. Well, maybe if they looked in the right places and didn't provide so much cover for probably the most corrupt government we've ever seen in Australian history, well, maybe a lot of the worst excesses of Robodebt might never have happened, or at least not gone on for 4.5 years.
It hasn't been ignored by the media, but it certainly hasn't got the prominence that you'd think such a big scandal would have got. I note too that Catherine Campbell is now starting to get into some trouble for her role, but she was also in charge of it and also seemed to not quite understand what she was doing in terms of it didn't ever occur to her that this might have been against her charter. So again, there are those in the media and who are friends with the media and who in the Liberal Party who are quite happy for the blame to fall on one or two people just so it doesn't go on them. A better media would have been on this still and finding everyone responsible. And it's all out there. The reports are out there. The reports are very comprehensive. Now they're 900 pages or 1,000 pages or something. And it's been the culmination of a four-year campaign. And you're right, Asher Wolf deserves a lot of credit and awards and the thanks of the Australian people, because this was an extremely damaging, destructive and tragic policy that could have just gone on. I suspect the new government might have repealed it, but they would have repealed it quietly and those responsible would have got away with it, and they shouldn't get away with it.
And the leader of the opposition, Peter Dutton, he's trying to sweep all of this under the carpet, suggesting that it's all in the past and we have to look at the future. Well, yes, I think we can look at the future. The National Anti-Corruption Commission would be very interested in looking at the sealed section of the Robodebt Royal Commission report to see if Peter Dutton's name is one of those people featured. So these are very exciting things to be looking at in the future. And of course, Peter Dutton will keep deflecting from the Robodebt disaster. That's what all governments try to do, either trying to forget about it or saying that it's all in the past or making it seem like it was actually a Labor Party scheme and that it's the Labor government who were the ones who were trying to politicise all of this. And he's got a by-election to win over the weekend, so he will say whatever he needs to say at this stage, but Robodebt is much bigger than the Fadden by-election or an opposition leader trying to save his political skin. The politics of this has to be played out, or it will be played out in whichever way it needs to, and the government will milk this for all it's worth. But whether there's a political advantage to this or not for the Labor government, the Department of Public Prosecutions just needs to go through and charge those people responsible for this illegal Robodebt scheme. Because I think it's just beyond all of these other political issues, and it's in the public interest for them to do this.
It's protectors protecting protectors protecting protectors, and everybody gets protected and nothing comes through. This is why the system has to change, and I think the system is changing. It's just crazy.
You're listening to New Politics. You can subscribe to us on Apple or Google Podcasts, listen through Spotify, YouTube, SoundCloud and Amazon Music, or you can find us at newpolitics.com.au. And you can now support New Politics through Patreon.
And while all the dramas relating to Robodebt are continuing on the domestic scene, the Prime Minister Anthony Albanese has gone to the NATO Summit in Lithuania, and it's probably the most important meeting that NATO has ever had. It was held in the backdrop of the war in Ukraine, with Ukraine making a strong appeal to actually join NATO, and Sweden is also making the move to join NATO. Australia is not actually a part of NATO, and that's the North Atlantic Treaty Organisation, and unless there are some moves along the lines of the Eurovision Song Contest, Australia won't become a member of NATO anytime soon, although there has been some talk of expansion across to Asia, and that brought about the ire of former Prime Minister Paul Keating, who claimed that it would bring the militarism of Europe into the Asia region, and that exporting this malicious poison to Asia would be like welcoming the plague. And I think, Mr. Keating, you've gone a bit too far there. But Australia can play a big part in these forums. During the time of the Abbott and Morrison governments, there was a bit of a retreat from international involvement, but it is important that Australia plays its part in international affairs and diplomacy.
NATO is problematic, of course. Its critics claim that it is just a way for America to get its troops into Europe without actually having to invade and to extend American foreign policy. Do we want that here? We already have it here. Do we want it extended? Definitely not. Yet you can't just say no. I know that a lot out there will say you just say no, but it's more difficult than that. There are implications. Having said that, you can be critical. You can decline to take part in certain things. You can force compromise. We hope that the Prime Minister is more than just a lapdog for American interests. We will see. And you're absolutely right. Again, it is important that Australia plays a part. Australia can play a critical, wiser, cooler head part. We hope that they start to do that.
And all of this talk about Airbus elbow is getting a rerun in the conservative media, and most notably from Sky News, and quite a lot of it is also in the Australian newspaper as well. And there's never a suggestion about what the alternative is. And of course, there was never a suggestion that Scott Morrison shouldn't be travelling around the world for important international meetings when he was Prime Minister. But as we've discussed, David, Australia does need to be part of these processes because Australia is a part of the international community. And I think we mentioned this before, but at the same time that Anthony Albanese was at the NATO summit, trying to resolve world problems. Scott Morrison was probably at an Italian gelato bar in the Italian Riviera, and Scott News didn't mention anything about that at all. And maybe they'll send a roving reporter to hound and harass him when he returns back at Sydney Airport, just like they did with Senator Katie Gallagher at the Canberra Airport a few weeks ago. And again, I'm just pointing this out to show the duplicity of the conservative media in Australia. And it's almost like they believe that Anthony Albanese is too much of a scrubber to represent Australia overseas. And we have to remember what the sacked ABC journalist Andrew Probyn said, that Anthony Albanese isn't appealing to the smart end of the street. He's appealing to the people who clean the streets. So that's how the mainstream media pretty much thinks, that Liberal Party leaders are classy and smart, doesn't matter how inept and corrupt they are, but Labor Party leaders are uncouth and unpalatable and couldn't possibly represent Australia overseas. And I think that's what the subtext is here.
Oh, definitely. And what's wrong with appealing to the people who clean the street? What type of classist nonsense is that? Andrew Probyn should know much better. All voters deserve to be heard. All voters deserve to be spoken to properly. All voters deserve to have information. Just classist, elitist nonsense that has no place from a senior journalist.
And I guess there's also the question of whether the Prime Minister is spending too much time overseas. And essentially, a Prime Minister just has to do what's in the national interest. But it seems that Anthony Albanese is aware of this issue. And Australia is not like Europe, where everything is close by and national leaders are expected to travel widely. And I think there's still a bit of a cultural cringe in Australia. And there is that perception that anyone, whether it's a worker or a CEO or a politician, that if they're going overseas, that they're going on a junket or it's some sort of holiday. And it's going to be a lazy slack time, when it's actually anything but all of these things. But Anthony Albanese seems to be doing quick focus trips, doing the business that needs to be done, and then heading back quickly to Australia. And this is the job of a Prime Minister. They all have to do it, and whether they like it or not. And you wouldn't want the Governor General doing all of this work and getting his wife to sing to Emmanuel Macron halfway through a meeting. But NATO summits are not just about politics and diplomacy anyway. It's almost like an arms and military hardware shop where a lot of military deals are made. Australia has set up a military deal with Germany for the sale of $1 billion worth of combat vehicles. And Anthony Albanese also met with the Ukraine president, Volodymyr Zelensky, and promised 30 more Australian-built Bushmaster vehicles. And it's hard to argue against the delivery of this when you're dealing with Vladimir Putin on your doorstep, who's doing his absolute best to destroy Ukraine and possibly the rest of Europe. But depending on what happens to Vladimir Putin and Russia over the next year or two, and possibly over the next few months, the European landscape is being reframed and reworked in a very, very big way. And Australia isn't physically close to where all of this is happening, so it's not being felt so strongly here. But this is one of the biggest and most dynamic changes to happen in Europe for some time, and world politics as well. And it really is essential that Australia be a big part of this.
It's better to be inside trying to make a difference than outside making no difference. And it's problematic, sure. And Australia will probably do things that a lot of us won't like, sure. But I would rather a Prime Minister, and a competent Prime Minister, a Prime Minister who's not going to embarrass us, be there doing it. And the other thing, for all the talk of Albo being overseas, an Airbus Albo, I don't think he's gone overseas on holidays yet. He did have a holiday in January, and to be fair, I don't know where he went, but he didn't disappear as soon as there was a disaster and then try and blame his wife on it or his partner. So the whole Airbus Albo campaign is a weird type of what they call a whataboutism, in that he's always overseas, even though each overseas trip he's had has been more or less justifiable.
This is New Politics, one of the top 10 Australian politics and news commentary audio programs. You can listen to us on Apple and Google Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, Amazon Music, and you can find us at newpolitics.com.au, and you can contribute and support New Politics on Patreon. Hey, 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 hey
And getting back closer to home, there is a new campaign of misinformation against the federal government's Combating Misinformation and Disinformation Bill. Now, the bill is actually at the draft exposure stage where public consultations are invited, and then the full bill will be presented to Parliament later on this year. Now, the response to this misinformation and disinformation bill has been quite predictable. Sky News and the rest of News Corporation has started running a campaign against it, which of course has used a lot of misinformation, and that means that the Liberal Party is also against it too. But sometimes in politics, it's best not to reveal too much of your intentions, and it's obvious what's going on here. The entire News Corporation business model is based on misinformation and disinformation, and the Liberal Party's existence and modern success is based on spreading as many lies as possible. And we're seeing a good example of this in the current Voice to Parliament No campaign. So it's obvious that misinformation and disinformation legislation is not in their interest, and they'll use misinformation to stop this from going ahead. Now, it's not clear how far this bill will go and how effective it will actually be in stopping misinformation through media platforms. It's actually quite weak legislation. It's almost as though the industry has written it up itself. But it's clear that something has to be done about it because it's just gone on for far too long.
It's funny that in countries where you have these types of bills, you have a better media. New Zealand, Canada, most of Europe. In countries where you don't have these types of bills, you have a terrible media. United Kingdom, United States, Australia. This is a good start. It's nowhere near enough, but it is a good start. And the fact that those most likely to break the law in terms of that legislation are complaining is probably enough to suggest that it's a good idea.
Well, I just really love this intense irony of News Corporation and the Liberal Party raging against the disinformation bill. And I think that most people, based on what we've seen on social media and the mainstream media for some time, would want to see some level of control on this. And it's just that the sewer pipe of misinformation has really gone out of control. And it's really hard to see where all of this will end. And these proposals, or this proposed legislation, it's got the ire of radical libertarians and the free speech at all cost advocates coming out, and they just don't want to see any restrictions at all. But with the process of expanding freedom of speech to just go out and say whatever you want, doesn't matter how offensive or ridiculous or untruthful it is, with this expansion, I think there's been a reduction of the responsibility for all of these actions. And so these people just don't want any restrictions, and they don't want any responsibilities with it as well. So what they want is just an open slather. It's the Liberal Party, sections of the National Party, One Nation. It's all of those Tim Wilson types. It's News Corporation. It's much of the mainstream media. They'll just never take responsibility for their actions.
They want the right to do everything with the responsibility for nothing, which is how they governed. Free speech is somewhat misunderstood. Free speech is really the ability to criticise a government and its policies without fear of being arrested or persecuted for it. So a government can actually put in legislation that stops you using racist terms because it's not really free speech. A company can stop people saying things about the company because it's not really about criticizing the government. You might not like the company you work for, but if you say that publicly, they have the right to sack you. It's not really an episode of free speech in that case.
Well, we also had that Israel Folau issue in rugby union.
The rugby union decided that what Israel Folau was saying was not within their own corporate culture and within their own ideals and beliefs, and so they let him go. That's not a free speech issue, no matter how much they try and tell you it is. That's between the rugby union and Israel Folau. We're allowed to come on every week and criticise the government, praise the government, not be bothered by the government, without fear of retribution, provided we don't slander anybody unfairly or slander anybody, and provided we don't say anything otherwise illegal. And that's as it should be. And that's anyone who wants to set up their own podcast and do that, or their own blog, or their own pamphlets, or drive around and carry placards around. You're allowed to do that. And that's the limits of free speech.
Now, having said all of this and the need for better control over misinformation, disinformation, and outright abuse, I'm not sure if this proposed bill from the Labor government is the solution. I'm actually not sure what it is, but it needs to work towards truth in journalism and truth in politics legislation, as you mentioned before, David. And for me, it's unacceptable that outright lies cannot be told in advertising, but there's no restrictions for politicians and public debate. Now, I'm not suggesting that those advertising rules shouldn't exist, but there's greater ramifications that arise from political debate and discourse. And looking at the bill, it will give the Australian Communications and Media Authority, that's ACMA, they will give ACMA the powers to gather information, develop a code of conduct and create an industry standard. And it won't have any powers to remove any offending material. And it's not going to apply to election or referendum material. So that would mean that all the racist, misleading and lying material that's been put out by the No campaign in the current Voice to Parliament debate, that wouldn't be covered anyway. So there's not really that much that's in this legislation. The legislation or the bill just seems to be so weak, it's hard to know why it's being put up. And if I was News Corporation, I'd just shut up, congratulate the Labor government, then get back to business as usual, because not much is going to change from this. Something far stronger is needed. And I'm just wondering what the Minister for Communications, Michelle Rowland, has been up to over the past 14 months, because the media needs to be reformed, the ABC needs to be rebuilt from the ground up and made more relevant for the digital age. And after 14 months, this is all we get. I just don't think that it's good enough.
As I said, I think it's a step in the right direction. A lot more needs to be done. I think a Royal Commission into the media is really where the proper process of reform starts. Again, I'm wondering if Labor has done this just to delay so they can come up with something better, perhaps. And I know that there's half of our audience now saying, oh, come on. Or maybe they think it's enough. You know, if we do this, this will keep the critics quiet and we can get on with the business of government and we're not upsetting the press at all. I do wonder why Labor is so scared of News Corp. We know that they're going to give them bad press. So I don't know why they keep trying to treat them nicely in the hope that they give them good press. You get one or two good headlines, sure, but over time, it doesn't work that way. So hopefully there's longer-term plans in the pipeline, but we won't know till we know.
And a few final observations about the by-election in Fadden, which is going to be held today, and that's Saturday the 15th of July. And perhaps by the time some of our audience listen to this episode, it's going to be all over, bar the shouting. But there's not that much interest in this by-election. It's not like the Aston by-election, which had a much greater media presence in the build-up to election day. And perhaps most of the Conservative media saw Aston as a big opportunity for the Liberal Party and for Peter Dutton to get back into the political game and booked all of these subsequent media appearances, anticipating him giving a winning narrative only for the Liberal Party to be the first opposition party to lose a seat in a by-election in over 100 years, and for Dutton needing to go into the media to explain why the Liberal Party lost so badly. So they're probably trying to avoid that situation in the seat of Fadden, but we can see that both sides of politics are managing expectations, with Peter Dutton suggesting that the Liberal National Party will lose some ground and the Labor Party suggesting that they've got absolutely no chance of winning. And if this is all what ends up happening, well, that's easier to explain away. But if it's actually a better result for either side, well, they can claim that it's an even better result than it actually is.
I don't know what's going to happen. It's a wide field, 13 candidates. The hope, I guess, would be that it goes to one of the independent candidates. I'm told that none of them have quite a big enough presence in the seat to really grab the narrative in the way that some of the other successful independents were able to in other seats. I think it's going to go down to the Stuart Robert question. And then is the support for the Liberal Party there strong enough to transcend that? I'm not prepared to say who's going to win because I think you'd almost need a polling booth by polling booth knowledge of the seat. And it does sound like I'm hedging my bets here a bit, and I am a bit, but it's a hard seat to know. This is the seat that put Stuart Robert back in after it was shown that he'd spent thousands and thousands on an internet access for no real reason that anyone can quite tell. So it's not a seat that is terribly engaged in politics, I suggest. And to our listeners in Fadden who are terribly engaged in politics, I exclude you from that overgeneralization, of course. But from the outside, it's like most by-elections, it's hard to tell.
No, I think that this election is very important, or this by-election is very important, but we'll say that pretty much about any electoral event that happens in Australia or in the world, actually. And we have said this previously, but it's a very simple equation in this by-election. Any improvement in the Liberal National Party vote will be seen as a vindication of Peter Dutton, and we'll see the unfortunate continuation of his terrible brand of toxic leadership. And if you're getting the idea that we're not fans of the leadership style of Peter Dutton, well, you're absolutely right. And as bad as Scott Morrison was, Australia dodged a bullet when Peter Dutton lost that Liberal Party leadership battle back in 2018. But any increase in the Liberal National Party vote will be seen as an encouragement to continue with this high level of negativity and toxicity. But a significant drop in the vote, and most definitely if the seat is lost, well, that will see the end of Peter Dutton. And as you mentioned, David, this is a really difficult by-election to read. It ranges from an increase in the Liberal National Party vote to a narrow win for the Labor Party. But there's so many issues to take into account. There's the national polls. The support for Queensland Labor is dropping off. For federal Labor, Queensland is a bit of a graveyard as well. Albanese is popular, but dropping off slightly. Peter Dutton is seriously unpopular. There's Robodebt, there's Stuart Robert and his resignation. There's the relative strengths of each candidate. There's cost of living pressures, there's other issues going on in politics as well, not just nationally, but also in the seat of Fadden. So it is really hard to read what will happen, but this by-election is more about the here and now. It's all about Peter Dutton's leadership. So it's more about that than offering any ideas about what might happen at the next federal election in 2025. And in many ways, it's very similar to the Eden Monaro by-election in July 2020, when that was seen as a test of Anthony Albanese's leadership, and Labor went on to narrowly hold onto that seat, and the rest is history. So Peter Dutton is in a similar position here, but it's just really hard to see how this is all going to play out. Here's Anthony Albanese giving his opinion about what the result will mean for Peter Dutton.
Well, Peter Dutton, I don't expect that any result will change what characterises his opposition. He has taken the position of opposition leader far too literally, because he's opposed to everything. He's opposed to the Housing Australia Future Fund. He's opposed to any initiatives. We've seen the debacle where this week, after his own shadow ministers had various views about what should happen with the position of the Reserve Bank Governor, he's actually been campaigning and being against something that wasn't even happening. So I don't think that will change. Traditionally, there are swings away from a government of around about 4 to 5% in a by-election. Fadden and the northern part of the Gold Coast have only ever returned LNP members. They have never returned Labor members federally since Federation. But our candidate is a great candidate. She's out there. I was very happy to launch her campaign. And the Labor Party are running so that people have that choice. But I don't expect anything like the Aston by-election result. That was an extraordinary result. The first time in 100 years that the government have won a seat off the opposition, and the circumstances there were quite unique way back in 1920 with someone recontesting who'd been accused of treason at the time in the seat of Kalgoorlie. So I would expect that the voters will have their say, but I don't expect that anything will change for the coalition, and anything will change for Peter Dutton.
Peter Dutton will likely not survive this unless it's a win for the Liberal Party. it won't save him if it is a win, I don't think, because if it is a win, that's kind of expected in this type of by-election anyway. It might give him another couple of events. Really, the best he can hope for, I think, is a stay of execution. He might face the next election. I have the sense that he will. If Labour drops in the polls and it looks like that there's a winnable Liberal Party in the next one or two elections, suddenly there'll be people quite desperate for his job who can smell the chance of perhaps becoming Prime Minister. He's been a bit lucky at the moment that his own party has done so poorly and that the Labour Party is still held well in that he's been able to keep the job. I think the second there's a chance of viability to become government, his job is gone anyway. But I also suspect there will be those Liberal Party people who think they won't have 2 or 3 years to waste and will want to get rid of him by the next election just so that they can speed up the rebuilding process. So, yeah, Fadden, I don't think it will damage the Prime Minister that much. It will send a message to the government that things need to be done. I don't think Anthony Albanese's job is under any threat if Fadden is not won by the Labour Party. I do think Peter Dutton's job is under threat if Fadden is not won by the Liberal Party. But I do think that it won't actually improve Peter Dutton's position at all. And then unless he wins the next election, he'll be gone after that. And I don't think he can win the next election.
And we also had some late news that came in that Philip Lowe will not be reappointed as the Reserve Bank Governor. And the new governor will be Michelle Bullock. And she's currently the Deputy Governor of the Reserve Bank. And she's been at the Reserve Bank since 1984. And she'll take up the position in September. And she'll also be the first woman to hold the job of Reserve Bank Governor. Now, David, I think you and I probably would have had a better chance than Philip Lowe of being reappointed as the Reserve Bank Governor, and we probably would have done a much better job as well. And I was actually looking forward to pulling out the suit from the wardrobe if we did get the job and parading in a suit and tie around Martin Place in Sydney, but
they'll regret it.
They will regret it, but it was not to be. So this seems to be a change in direction for the Reserve Bank, but it's a change that just had to be made, I think.
Lowe's position was untenable. We all knew that. Even if those interest rate hikes were made at the right time, which most economists agree they weren't, and certainly most people relying on lower interest think they weren't, even if he had been otherwise competent and qualified member of the Reserve Bank Board, the things he said about how to deal with interest rate rises were just so incredibly wrong-headed as to disqualify him. The government was right to not extend his contract. He'll still be there till the 17th, but he knows now that he's either got to retire or find a new job. It's hard to know what to say about the new candidate. She's been with the Reserve Bank all her career, which is probably a good thing. Funnily enough, the government didn't listen to Peter Dutton's suggestion that they not get a public servant in. Why the papers reported that, I really don't know. It's hardly news that Peter Dutton will oppose something. Michelle Bullock wasn't the name that was touted. There were two other front runners, apparently, but neither of them seem to have been considered. I've already seen a little bit of criticism that she was just Lowe's deputy and she won't be any better. We can't really know that till she starts. Of course, many of you would have worked for people who you didn't like and didn't really agree with, but in the interests of maintaining your salary and your career, did your best with it and waited for the opportunity to be able to do things in what is presumably a better way. So we can't really say if she'll be good or she'll be bad. I do agree with some of the criticism saying that it doesn't matter who the governor is. It's the whole mechanism that needs to change. And I think that that's one of the things that the government probably should do. And in fact, they've started that in splitting the board into two, one to look at interest rates and one to do the rest of the work of the Reserve Bank. That will hopefully work. Hopefully the two boards will be able to work together in their own lanes or in their own demarcation for many, many years. We could be moving into a new era of good Reserve Bank governance here. Being the eternal optimist, I kind of hope we are. It does remain to be seen, but we'll be looking carefully at how she goes. I should also point out too that have they brought in a woman to clean up a man's mess again? That's an important point to consider too.
That's it for this episode of New Politics. Thanks for listening in. And if you'd like to support our style of journalism and commentary, please make a donation at our website at newpolitics.com.au. We don't beg, plead, beseech or gaslight you about journalism coming to an end. We just keep it very simple. If you like what we do, please send some support our way. It keeps our commitment to independent journalism ticking along. I'm Eddie Djokovic. Thanks for listening in, and it's goodbye to our listeners.
I'm David Lewis. We'll see you next time.